Hey everyone, I'm Yiannis Christoulas, and this video's question is, what does real science have to say about increasing our flexibility fast and easily? In this video, I will present you the most effective strategy proven by 32 recent studies and my personal experience as a coach and athlete. Let's get started. So the first thing that I want you to understand is that getting flexible is not about the type of the exercise that you're doing. The exercises that stretch the muscles that you want are all over the internet and are very easy to find. Just type the words flexibility workout or routine and you'll have millions of results. The thing is, what are you going to do with them? It's like searching for a good leg exercise and finding squats. What are you going to do with them? Even though you know the right exercise, you still have to find the right weight, reps, sets, rest between sets, and number of sessions per week to get the results that you want. It's the same with flexibility. It's easy to find the exercises, but they are only one component of your flexibility session. The others are the method that you're going to use, the time of stretch per set, the number of sets per session, the duration of rests between sets, and the number of sessions per week. Only if you set all these components right, you will gain flexibility fast and easily. So without further ado, let's see what science has to say about all this. So the consensus view of the scientists, as you already know, is that regular stretching increases range of motion. This is supported by numerous studies that have tested the effects of various types of stretching on flexibility. But which of them is more effective in increasing range of motion? The four big categories of stretching techniques are the dynamic stretching, where the person moves dynamically through his range of motion with controlled mobility drills, ballistic stretching, which involves a less controlled muscular effort and uses a bouncing type movement in which the end position is not held, static stretching, where you stretch and hold your position for a specific amount of time, and proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation, or else PNF techniques. These techniques are performed mostly with a partner and are combined by three different phases: a passive pre-stretch, a type of muscular activation, and the passive stretch again. Some of these methods are combined with different techniques, but we use these four big categories to distinguish the main characteristics of the type of stretching that we're using. If you are new to these terms and want a more integrated description of these four types of stretching, I will have some relevant articles from a blog linked below. Now, the current literature suggests that static stretching and PNF are superior in increasing range of motion compared to dynamic stretching and ballistic stretching. Specifically, in studies that compared ballistic stretching with static stretching was superior in increasing range of motion. In addition, in a recent review from 2018, where scientists compared the efficiency of all methods in terms of improving range of motion, ballistic stretching was found to have the smallest effect in comparison to all the other types of stretching. This doesn't mean that you can't increase your flexibility with dynamic and ballistic stretching, but only that you'll have a smaller positive effect in comparison to static stretching and PNF. Also, ballistic stretching is considered to be the riskiest in terms of injury, and some scientists suggest that it is no longer recommended. I personally believe that every type of stretching is suitable for specific occasions and that ballistic stretching could be beneficial for specific movements. So from the literature, it's clear that both static stretching and PNF are very successful methods in terms of increasing range of motion. But which of the two is the most effective and suitable for you? Right now, there are studies which support that PNF is better than static stretching, but also others that found no differences between them and some that found static stretching to be better than PNF. A review on this topic from Sherman and co-workers in 2006 concluded that PNF is the most effective means to increase range of motion by way of stretching, particularly in respect to short-term gains in range of motion. On the other hand, in a review from Lepke and colleagues in 2018, the authors came to the result that PNF stretching was not demonstrated to be more effective at increasing hamstring extensibility compared to static stretching. Finally, in another review in the same year that compared 23 studies with all stretching typologies, authors conclude that the static stretching protocols showed significant gains when compared to the ballistic and PNF protocols. What I'm trying to say here is that the results are mixed, but the main point here is that both methods are very close in terms of increasing range of motion. Slight differences that may have been found between them will not make the difference of the average person in practice. For me, the major difference is that static stretching can be more easily applied by the person itself and in every muscle group. On the contrast, and as NSCA states in their fourth edition of the Essentials, PNF stretching is often impractical because most of the stretches require a partner and some expertise. But even if you do it yourself, it's much harder and almost impossible to correctly apply it on some very important muscle groups like the glutes and the muscles of the lower back. So for this reason, and with the data that we currently have, I think that static stretching is probably the most suitable method for the average person out there in terms of increasing flexibility. But that doesn't mean that PNF can have an equal or in some cases greater result in range of motion. I just think that both methods are very effective and close in terms of results, but static stretching is easier to apply on yourself and in every muscle group. Now, knowing the right type of stretching is just the beginning for a successful flexibility program. The next step is to look for the optimal parameters of your flexibility session. These parameters are the time of stretching per set, the number of sets per session, the duration of rests between sets, and the number of sessions per week. Early studies of Bandy and Co-workers in 1994 and 1997 showed that the optimal duration of a stretch is 30 seconds. In their study, they used 15, 30, and 60 second sets, and found that stretching for 30 seconds significantly improved range of motion, while no increase in flexibility occurred when the duration was increased from 30 to 60 seconds. On the other hand, a review that I mentioned before from Thomas and colleagues in 2018 put the weight on a different aspect of training. In this review, the authors found that time spent stretching per week seems fundamental to elicit range of motion improvements when stretches are applied for at least or more than 5 minutes, where the time spent stretching within a single session does not seem to have significant effects for range of motion gains. So the actual goal is to reach somewhere close to 10 minutes per week total stretching duration, while stretching more than 10 minutes per week will not elicit more gains in your flexibility. If we combine these results with the two papers of Bandy and colleagues, it will be fair to say that the optimal strategy would be 3 sets of 30 seconds and for 6 days per week. With this training regime, you reach 9 minutes total stretching duration per week, and you are in agreement with both the findings of Bandy and the big recent review of Thomas. If you can't have so many sessions per week, and given the fact that the total duration is the most important factor, you should try to make this time in less sessions. For example, 3 sessions with 3 sets of 60 seconds. This is a very effective protocol that I personally use to my athletes and myself. So the number of sessions per week, the sets per session, and the duration per set are mostly determined by the total stretching duration per week, which is around 10 minutes. To my knowledge, the duration of the rests between sets hasn't been studied yet, so I would say that anywhere between 1 to 2 minutes should be okay, and it's pretty much what was used in most of the studies I presented. And now, an essential clue for successful stretching that I bet you didn't know. This one came from Wyon in 2009. In their study, they had 24 adolescent dancers in a 6-week intervention program that compared low-intensity stretching with moderate-intensity static stretching on active and passive range of motion. According to them, microstretching is a new modality that reduces the possibility of the parasympathetic system being activated. The main finding of this study was that very low-intensity stretching had a greater positive effect on lower limb range of motion than moderate-intensity static stretching. If you are familiar with this type of static stretching, just forget about it. A gentle and controlled stretching with low intensity will produce greater flexibility results, as was found by Wyon and co-workers. Last but not least, warm-up, breathing, and periodization. Should you warm up before a flexibility session? It is common sense that you shouldn't go completely cold into a full stretch. For most people, the simplest way to warm up before stretching is to put your flexibility training in the end of your normal workout. That way your muscles are already warm and ready to go. But if you prefer to do your stretching separately from your other workouts, you should take the time to warm up before you stretch. I personally use a 5 to 10 minutes low intensity physical activity to increase my temperature, and after that I do my whole flexibility session with the Anderson method. In this method you simply do an easy pre-stretch of 10 to 30 seconds and then you go on a developed stretch for 30 to 60 seconds, which is your main training. This way I'm already warm in terms of temperature and also easing into a full stretch. What about breathing? Always make sure that you gently breathe out during your stretch. Calm and slow breathing can help your muscles relax and decrease the activity of neural reflexes that oppose your stretch. And last, what about flexibility training and periodization? I think is a simple but essential concept that people forget when it comes to flexibility training. When you try to get more flexible, you're not just doing a warm-up routine or making a quick pass from recovery exercises. You are training your flexibility, so this can be an independent training session throughout your day. As a training procedure, every 6 to 8 weeks, there should be a rest period of 3 to 5 days or a deload week where you will do 20 to 30% less than your typical training. So what you can personally do if you want to get more flexible is select the muscles that you want to get more flexible and find the exercises that stretch them. After a 5-minute low intensity warm-up, get right into your first set with the Anderson method. Pre-stretch for 15 seconds and then develop stretch for 60 seconds. Repeat that for 3 sets and for 3 sessions per week. After a period of 6 to 8 weeks, you can test your results. So let's conclude what we know about flexibility training. Static stretching and PNF are both very effective methods in terms of increasing flexibility. Static stretching might have a slight advantage over PNF because it's easier to apply it yourself and in every muscle. Time spent stretching per week is more important than time spent stretching within a single session, so if you can, stretch regularly up to 6 times per week for 3 sets and 30 seconds every set. If you can't, 3 sets of 60 seconds 3 times per week will be equally effective. Very low intensity stretching seems to have a greater positive effect on range of motion than moderate intensity static stretching, so don't try to tear your muscles apart. Make sure to warm up before going to a full stretch if you don't train your flexibility after your normal workout. Keep your breath calm during stretching and maintain a rest period every 6 to 8 weeks of consistent flexibility training. So that's it guys, these are the general guidelines on how to train your flexibility, but also keep in mind that I will make a video specifically on how to do a split fast and easily. If you found this video helpful, make sure to like the video, and if you want more content like this, you can subscribe to my channel. See you next time!